I'm saying that the Minister of Science of Education couldn't come for reasons having to do with his functions in Brasilia. So instead of that, he sent he called asking for excuse and sent a video with the presentation he prepared for us. This will be a 20 minutes presentation. And then I used the opportunity of having Professor Maria Helena Guimarães Castro on my right side here to talk, to make some say something about the Brazilian education with some emphasis on issues of the role of the education system in teacher education and the links between higher education and general education. Professor Maria Helena was many things, but Vice Minister of Education, the head of National Education Research Institute, the Secretary of Education of State of São Paulo. So it's a privilege to have her here with us today. So, and then we'll have the presentation by Professor Moshen Elmadi Said, which also is a kind of a gift for us. He came from Egypt to present the experience of Egypt in higher education and contribute to our discussions here. So I will start with the video. It's a 20 minutes presentation by the minister. Vamos começar com o vídeo, então. Professor Jacob Paris, who was the president of the Brazilian Academy, was supposed to chair the session, but he also will come later, so I'm starting on his behalf.
Good morning. I'd like to convey to all of you my best compliments as Minister of Education of Brazil to tell you that it's a great moment for our country to host this meeting convened by the Brazilian Academy of Sciences that will discuss, that has been discussing since yesterday, and that will still discuss the whole day today, the ways we can take in order to improve academic quality and inclusion. I will talk about social inclusion and academic quality as is in the program. I apologize for not being able to be with you physically since the requirements of my post have made that I stay in Brasilia for the whole day. But I'd like to begin my comment with a quote from Saint-Exupéry, the great French author that most people know from his book, Le Petit Prince. Many of us must have read it when we were children, and a lot of lessons may have been drawn from this beautiful book. But I will consider another book, Terre des Hommes, that he published in 1939, so on the eve of the Second World War, and that ends by an experience that he had some years before, in the mid-30s, when he was traveling in a train that brought many Polish workers from France to Poland. They had lost their jobs. They were coming home. This was a third-class train, so the circumstances were very difficult for everybody. And then he saw a small boy, and the boy was beautiful. And the boy was sleeping on the nap of his mother with his father at her side. And he was fascinated by this child. And then he began to think, this can be Mozart. This could be Mozart. This could be the great Austrian composer or some other genius of our history. The beauty of this small boy or the possibilities he could carry inside him. But he went on and he thought, but this is Mozart assassiné. This passage is quite well known by this title, Mozart assassiné, murdered Mozart. All the possibilities this boy could give to the world, all the possibilities he could himself develop were being murdered by the circumstances that afflicted him. These are the last pages of the book. The book ends with this sad memory, the sad idea, that a lot of possibilities are destroyed in the world due to poverty, due to war, due to destruction. This is the point where we must begin to discuss our question. What is the meaning of social inclusion with academic quality when we have a country that has murdered so many Mozart, so many Mozarts in the last centuries. Everybody knows in Brazil, but I think most of our foreign guests don't know, education took a very long time to develop in Brazil. In fellow countries of Latin America, the first university was created by the Spaniards in the mid-1530s, 500 years ago. In Brazil, the first university we had has been created in the 1920s, so less than 100 years ago. On the other side, we had an emperor, Dom Pedro II, that ruled for almost 50 years in the 19th century. That was a very cultivated man, almost a scholar, that liked education but did almost nothing in order to provide Brazil with an educational system. Education took a very long time to develop in the country, either as basic education as or as higher education. So, for instance, in 1968, when I began my higher education studies, we had only 100,000 university students in the whole country of Brazil, 100,000, less than 50 years ago. In 2003, when President Lula was inaugurated, we had less than 4 million university students in Brazil. It was 3.9, to be precise. Now we have 7.3 million students in Brazilian universities. It means in the last 12 years, we were able to raise the number of university students in Brazil by, say, 90%. It was a huge endeavor, and it was linked to a series of measures that tried to include many people that have been socially excluded for a very long time in the country, mostly people from African or Indian descent and poor people. So what has been done in the last years? First of all, several federal universities have been created. Around 20 federal new universities have been created in the last 12 years, as well as more than 100 new campuses of the same federal universities. And we were able at the same time to provide access to the university for poor people. This means several measures were taken. One of them is to ensure they have a sort of quota. This is our brand of affirmative action. It means that in federal universities, half of the students should enter that come from public school in Brazil, from public middle schools. In Brazil, usually, basic education, when it's provided by the state, is not good. When it's private, it's better, usually. But in the universities, it's the contrary. Universities which are private are not so good as the public ones. So one point that's very cruel, socially speaking, is that people who have money will go to universities that are free, because public education in Brazil is free. They pay nothing for it. While people who come from poorer backgrounds and have studied at public schools during their basic education years will go to higher education institutions that are paid and that are not so good. This is one of the points, one of the problems we have. So in order to foster social inclusion in the universities, we had to give them, first of all, quotas. Half of the students that enter the universities shall come from public schools. This is a law that will have to be fully obeyed in the next few years. A time was given to every university, every federal university, in order to make its own way to get this result. But most of them have already reserved half of their place for those students. Second point, inside these 50% of students that come from public schools, there are ethnic quotas benefiting most of all people from African and from Indian descent. They are people that are excluded in the country. Quite often they do not have the same opportunities as people who are white and come from richer backgrounds. So our quota systems include two main questions. From one side, people who come from public school. On the other side, people who come from an ethnic background. The other half of the places in the university is free for all. I mean, people can enter them, can get their places without quotas. And so people who come from richer backgrounds still they have their place in the university. At the same time, as I have told you, we more or less doubled the number of the places in the universities. So for people who are neither poor nor from ethnic minorities, they have the same number of places to enter the university as they had 10 years ago. They lost nothing. What the government tried to do was to create new places so that the students that were historically discriminated against could enter their place without taking the other people's places. This was, has been, and still is, one of the main public policies. Other policies to ensure them with food and shelter. Without food and shelter, for many of them, it would be difficult to follow their studies. It was considered that it was not enough to give them place, but we should also provide them with the material means to study during 3, 4, 5 years. We must add that several studies that have been made showed that the performance of the quota students is not inferior to the performance of the other students. I mean, they don't have the same grades, they don't get the same grades when they apply to enter the university. They had a poorer education than richer people, so they need the quotas. But several studies have showed that in 1 year or a couple of years at most, most of them will have the same level of quality in their studies than people came from better schools than them. Because to get there, they have shown a lot of stamina. They have shown that they are very able to face challenges. We consider that the results of these students in the university are good and that academic quality is not jeopardized by their presence. I should add another point. I told you about the expansion of federal universities. A lot of new universities have been created, a lot of places and so on. But I should add that particular care has been given to their quality. We had in Brazil a lot of doctors without job. We have a good system of PhD training in Brazil. Historically, we say that we can boast of only one level of education in Brazil. This level is graduate studies. It has been consistently evaluated by CAPES. CAPES is an agency that belongs to the Ministry of Education, and that has historically been concerned with this evaluation and support of graduate studies in the whole country. CAPES job has been crucial in order to ensure that quality and quantity in the training of doctors and master degree holders are good. So we had, 10 years ago, some thousands of PhDs that had gotten their degree, but were not able to find jobs. At the same time, we had a lot of people who wanted to enter higher education, and they had no school, no institution to apply to. The creation of many campuses and of 20 new federal universities was able to give places to the students, as I told you before, but also jobs to the doctors that were jobless. So most of our new federal universities have as their faculty members majority of PhD degree holders, which helps a lot to to ensure the students will get a good quality in their education. At the same time, when you have a PhD degree holder, you know he's not only a teacher. He or she is not only a faculty member. He or she is a researcher. So in the new universities, particular attention has been taken to ensure that at least the best among the PhD degree holders can have some room for their research. This means a lot of new master degree and sometimes doctoral programs have been created all along Brazil. This is what we are doing. It's a big endeavor. When President Lula was inaugurated in 2003, we had 12.2% of net enrollment rate in the higher educational system. Now, I will deal with the net enrollment rate in the higher education. By this data, we mean people from 18 to 24 years old that are enrolled at higher education. We consider these people to be people who are studying at the right age. They should be, and they are, at a higher education institution. But I must add that we will consider not only those who are enrolled, but also those who already got their degree. I explain it. Many people get their degree at 22, 23, 24 years old. It's unfair to consider they are not at a higher education institution because they have already been and they got their degree. So when we discuss net enrollment rate, we always consider both people who are presently studying at a higher education institution and people who have already finished their studies getting their degree, the people who have achieved their studies at that level. So if you take the data for the beginning of President Lula's government, it was 12.2% of those people. I mean, only one for every eight young people from that age was enrolled or had concluded his or her studies at a university or another higher education institution. Now we have a little more than 20%. We have 20.2%, which means one for every five Brazilians have finished or are presently studying at a higher education institution. It's a good advance. We are proud of this. But of course, we should raise this number. We should enter the 30% band, and then in other years, continue to raise it in order to be at the same level as developed countries. This fact, these numbers, I told you, show we are following the right path. We are giving a lot of more people access to the universities. We are worried about their permanence, so we have these social programs that give them food and shelter, for instance. We give them faculty members that are, most of them, most of the new teachers, the new faculty members, PhD degree holders. And last, we are trying to do our best in order to raise the number. Before finishing, I should tell you we have taken the old technical schools that belonged to the federal system that have been created since 1909 by former President Nilo Peçanha. We have raised their number, but we also have given them a branch of higher education. So the federal institutes for science and technology are able to train people that are 15 to 17 years old, but also people older than them with a higher education quality for these older. And this is important for us because we want to raise the number of people with formation, with training in STEM, in science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. We consider that we also have to change a little the landscape of what's provided for people in higher education in Brazil. We should consider that several professions have very strict regulations, such as engineering, medicine, law, not everybody can practice law. It's necessary to have a degree. It's necessary to go to the bar to be approved by the Order of the Lawyers of Brazil, which is our name for the bar, for the bar examinations. But we have other professions that do not have the same requirements. So we have to devise new, different types of higher education for different requirements and different publics. Very likely, we will be very strict in the education for professional training that is ruled by specific laws that establish exactly what people should do in their jobs. I mean, for a doctor, a medical doctor, you must have a training that's very specific. But for other areas, we should maybe change what is being doing. New creations, the interdisciplinary bachelorships, are very interesting. But I saw that Professor Naumar de Almeida, the former provost of the University of Bahia, the Federal University of Bahia, is also at the seminar. I think he has, he is able to explain to you what he has been doing, which is very interesting. So social inclusion and academic quality, that was my subject, can be supplemented by several other interventions. I am sad not to be able to discuss with you, to answer questions from you, to answer, to give you more explanations. But anyway, I hope to have been of some help to you. And once again, I want to convey to you the best wishes of a good Congress, a Congress that can be beneficial for everybody. Thank you very much. Have a good day.
It's a pity that he couldn't really be here personally, because there are many issues he raised which we would like to comment. I'll just make one observation that he spoke mostly, not only about the public sector, and the public sector is 25%. Actually, the federal system is less than around 20% or less of the higher education sector. 70% is private, and so most of these programs refer to the public.
25% public.
Yeah, but this federal system is 18. It's 18 or something like that. Yeah. Well,
yes.
Okay, I'll give the word to you. Go ahead.
Well, first, good morning for all. I want to congratulate Simon for this seminar. And excuse me for my bad English, I didn't prepare nothing. And I will call your attention about two questions that I think that the minister didn't point out. First, that our biggest problem of inclusion in Brazil is the bad quality of basic education. Last week, the Minister of Education announced the results of the first national evaluation of children at the end of third grade with 8 years old or more in literacy, in Portuguese and math. And the results were tragic. Less than 40% of our children at the end of third grade are able to read and are able to understand, to read numbers. This is my, sorry, my, I esqueci. Sorry. Are you? Thank you.
Maybe it's the minister.
No, it's not.
He's calling.
Perhaps. Perhaps he is very. Sorry.
He heard her say poor
yes.
level, so.
He's worried about. You know, it's not the minister, but. Is the governor of São Paulo. Where are we? Well, let's say. Well, first, last week, the results of the national evaluation, national assessment of children of 8 years or more at the end of third grade was terrible. Only 37% of children are able to read one phrase or one paragraph. The most majority can only read words, isolated words. Then they can recognize the symbols. And in the case of mathematics, only 20% of our children, remembering that if we have 7 million students in higher education, we have 51 million students in basic education, in fundamental schools, elementary schools, low secondary level, and high schools. So there is a big mistargeting in Brazilian education system. And this mistargeting has to do with quality in basic education and with lack of access and quality at secondary level of schooling. Only 50% of our 19 years old people, considering the cohort, the whole, the cohort of 19 years old, only 50% have high, have the conclusion at high school. It's an absurd. And considering the 9 years of elementary school, only 60% of students are finishing elementary school in Brazil, the last number of the Ministry of Education, INEP. So the these big numbers show that we have big problems. First, we have problems of coordination among the three levels of government considering basic education policies in Brazil. We have 5,640 systems of education because our municipalities have autonomy to define curriculum, teacher training, career, and so on. Also the Brazilian states, the 27 Brazilian states. So there is a lack of coordination among federal government, central government, state government, and municipal government. This is one problem. But in my view, the biggest problem is that we don't have a national policy for teacher training and national guidelines for teacher career. In Brazil, to be a teacher is very complicated. Today, we have 2,200 teachers in Brazil. In 80% of these people have their undergraduate level in private universities, studying at night, and during the day they are working and go to faculties of pedagogy in the night to have an undergraduate certification and to be a teacher in a public schools. And these people, in general, they represent the first generation of their families because they are very poor and they make a big effort to develop these courses. They represent the first generation in their family that have a higher education degree. This is the problem. And all the programs of in-service teacher training are not dealing with the real problem because faculties of pedagogy, even federal faculties of pedagogy, they have a program that ignores the needs and the framework they have to develop to form the competences of the future teachers, and the teachers are leaving federal universities, federal faculties of pedagogy, and leaving private faculties of pedagogy without the basic competences the teacher have to be a good teacher. Everybody in this room knows that all the evidences and research about quality in education shows that teacher quality is one of the most important factors inside school level to explain the improving quality in public schools when we have a lot of students with lower backgrounds and coming from poor families and that live in neighborhoods very, very poor. This is our problem. And the Minister of Education is not thinking about that, because in the last 15 years, the Minister of Education didn't put in place a good program for teacher training, a good curriculum for faculties of teacher training. They are absolutely very ideological. They ignore the contents that students have to learn in the classroom, in public schools, and the Minister of Education is responsible for higher education in Brazil. Is the only authority in our institutional and political structure responsible to define what is the curriculum, what and how the future teachers have to learn to be a good teachers. We don't have clinical residents in our teacher training programs. We don't have good curriculum. In general, teachers leave faculties knowing a lot about macro, the philosophy of education, sociology of education, history of education, but they don't know how to teach a children to learn how to read. So this is our problem. At the end of high schools, we have 10% of students with adequate level of in mathematics, and only 25% in Portuguese. But the problem is in the beginning of basic schools. They don't learn how to read, they don't learn how to think, they don't learn how to write, and at the end of high school, we have a disaster in Brazilian education system. And of course, in higher education, the problems are very new. Everybody here knows and have heard the minister talking about quotas, the expansion, and so on. But the problem is not higher education. The problem is quality in basic education. Well, sorry, these are my comments, because I'm really convinced that if we don't put a big attention in quality and teacher training in basic education, it will be impossible to improve higher education.
Thank you. Perhaps... Okay. Oh, perhaps we could take one or two... A few questions and then move to Egypt. Okay, Luis Davidovich.
Thank you for this your sum up of new problems.
Luis.
My question is about
microphone.
My question is about the issue of responsibilities. Because you know, we usually say the government is responsible for that, but what about the responsibility of professors of universities? Because, you know, I once compared the curricula of federal universities, it's the State University of São Paulo, the Catholic universities, as far as forming teachers for basic education goes, and they all look the same. You know, they don't, they tell, you know, they teach their students how to I think, methods to teach science, methods to teach mathematics, but they don't know anything about mathematics or science. So I wonder what, you know, where the responsibility is, because it looks, it seems to be that our colleagues are very much responsible for that, colleagues in the universities. So I'd like to have your comments on that.
Rubens Penha, Cisne, the Getúlio Vargas Foundation. I would like to explore a bit the concept of subsidiarity, which is a scholastic concept which places the government as subsidiary to our actions. The situation is indeed catastrophic, and if I wonder if we could not think about plans having the people, the students who are in the tertiary sector, by means of an effort coordinated by the government, going to meet the secondary school students, going to somehow give back to the country what they get from public education for free, in an effort which should somehow be parallel to what we have done in Brazil with the Projeto Rondon regarding health, but with the education. I also wonder if the fellow colleagues from China, India, and South Africa could tell us something about that, because the situation is dramatic, and I think we need an effort from the society. The government right now is, I think we should not rely only on the government. It's a very difficult situation.
One more comment. Then I'll ask you to make a final comment, and then we'll move on.
Okay. Well, of course, Professor, I agree absolutely with your comments, because I think that, of course, there is a big responsibility of our colleagues at universities that they are not doing their job. Well, I am from University of Campinas. I have here colleagues from University of São Paulo, Federal University of Rio de Janeiro, and so on. The problem is that all the research about the programs of University of São Paulo, University of Unicamp, and federal universities in general, as the big research of Bernadette Gatti, shows that all the programs are bad. All the programs of federal courses of pedagogy and all the licenciaturas in math and science, they are terrible. The teachers are not learning, the students, the future teachers are not learning the contents and how to use these contents in a didactical way to teach the students. They don't know how to teach, and they are leaving the faculties without knowing how to teach. And this is our biggest problem, and I think that there is a big responsibility of our universities. In the state of São Paulo, it's incredible, because USP, Unicamp, and UNESP, UNESP is better than USP and Unicamp. UNESP has a big interaction with municipalities and with public schools. And it's a university that has, I think, 30 campuses around the state. But USP and Unicamp, they ignore public schools in general. They ignore. Or they think that Brazilian public schools are like Finnish public schools, that all the teachers will have autonomy to teach, they will have creativity to think about innovative curriculum and things like that, absolutely out of our concrete reality. And your question about students of third grade, there is programs in the United States like Teach for America that they have developed in India.
Now there is a program in South America called Teach for All. This program is organized by NGOs and private universities. They are trying to convince governors and mayors about the importance of having third grade students helping teachers at school level. And one problem that I didn't talk about, and in my view, is the perhaps the most difficult to face, and we have to have courage to face it, is corporatism, unions. In the Brazilian case, teacher unions, they are very, very powerful. In the state of São Paulo, teacher union have a big budget. They have a building of 13
floors.
Yes, in the Avenida Ipiranga, in downtown, the center of the city of São Paulo. They have a budget for media and marketing, biggest than the budget that the State Secretary of Education have, and they have a lot. They have more than 50 lawyers taking care of problemas trabalhistas. Yes, so it's a big structure. They are very powerful, and this year we have more than 18 Brazilian states having strikes of teachers. Strikes of 100 days, 120 days is not a strike of 1 week. It means that a lot of Brazilian children, they didn't have classes for 2, 3, 4 months. In the state of Santa Catarina, children have, they are beginning the year since July, because they beginning this year since February, from February to June, in having a strike. The same in Paraná, the same in São Paulo, the same in Rio de Janeiro last year, the same in Minas Gerais, all the states. What is going to happen with these children? Of course, at the end of the year, they will not have access to the curriculum. Of course, it's impossible to ensure that one curriculum supposed to be given during 200 days a year will be given in 100 days. It's impossible. This is Brazilian reality now. We are facing a big problem since Marisa Abreu is here. She's an expert in teacher career, and is really unbelievable what is going on with teacher career, strikes, and national policies for teacher training, and the results. Sorry, the minister, I respect a lot the minister. He's an important professor of University of São Paulo and important intellectual. But the problem is that we are losing one generation of children. In the last 5 years, Brazilian education in terms of quality, didn't move considering the results of Brazilian national assessment. We didn't move. So this is complicated.
Well, thank you very much. I think this issue of how you link higher education with general education is a very central issue, because of course we can discuss higher education, but if we ignore which kind of students we get there, and the discussion is very much on the empty. So I'll stop here with this part, and let's move to another part of the world. Professor Said, please.
Thank you very much. Hello. Well, I usually don't use any microphones when I give lectures, so if...
No, but it's working now.
It's working now, okay. Well, ladies and gentlemen, first of all, I would like to thank Professor Simon for inviting me to attend this wonderful discussions that I have been listening to for the past, for the second day today. He proposed actually to talk about dilemmas of social inclusion and academic quality, but since the dilemmas are everywhere, so I am just going to address the whole issues that are raised within this seminar here. And very rightfully, what Professor Maria said about the problems, we are facing the same identical problems in Egypt, as you will see from the presentation. So I will just try to review the whole dilemmas that we are facing, not only about the academic quality or social inclusion, but rather in every aspect of the higher education development agenda, as we will see through. I will just give you a very quick background on what I'm doing, and then we'll focus about the higher education in developing countries, the very topics that we have been discussed here. I will speak about the challenges and key issues that confront the higher education and for which we are really doing all the reform activities, the problems of access to higher education, and then I'll talk a little bit about the governance of the higher education system in Egypt, how it is funded, and what efforts are we doing towards developing the quality agenda there. And then the current reform agenda that we are pursuing. So it will give you a flavor of what is going on in Egypt. I have been directing since 1991 two projects, one for the engineering and technical education, and that really focused on developing the research infrastructure and laboratories and so on. It was a $38.8 million. And then after that, I was also directing the overall higher education enhancement project, and that was about $75 million funded by the World Bank, co-funded actually by the World Bank, and that really entailed developing an overall strategic plan for the higher education for the higher education system in Egypt, and they were translated into 25 projects with specific indicators to address and so forth. Currently, we have two ongoing projects in parallel. Because of the funding problem, we don't have a funding formula or any system of funding, so we are trying to adopt the system that is applied by the UK HEFC model, the Higher Education Funding Council for Education. And that is, we are currently doing a partnership with this institution to try to find a scholarships program based on merit or performance. And another one is promoting the partnerships among the higher education institutions and US institutions. And we have parallel programs with the German and the French, and many bilateral agreements focus on developing such partnerships. So, of course, this the international seminar touched upon the policies of access, the role of national and regional governments, the stakeholders and governance in higher education, science and technology, and elite universities. We have heard that, and currently we're in that session here. Then we will hear about the financing of the higher education next in the next session, and the institutional differentiation and assessments of quality assurance. So, all those issues I'm just going to address one at a time. Before developing any higher education system, we really have to identify the problems. And the problems we identified in our system were the poor organizational structures of some of our higher education institutions, the limited spaces available for access to higher education. The government is not able to cater for the whole education system, so they are opening streams for other education systems like private education, open and distance learning education, etc. Same very much. The imbalance between the public and private higher education institutions across provinces, that's a problem. The distribution is mainly in the main capital, and we want to cater, but nobody wants to invest in provinces, and that is creating a problem within the country for mobility and so on. The large number of students in humanities and social science, you will find that nearly three quarters of our system is in humanities and social sciences. And those are problems, by the way, across all the countries are available there. When you compare statistical information, you will find that most of the countries have the same issues here. The weak links between higher education institutions and the labor market, the industry, and so forth. So I'm raising those because I'm going to give you a global picture of how we are tying all this together and developing, because you cannot just follow one single track to reform the whole higher education. There are parallel tracks that you have to talk about. You have to coordinate all those efforts in order to reach a specific ultimate goal. And this is how I'll show you how this is being done. There is one of the major problems that were spelled out here is there is only one criteria for admission to the higher education, only from the secondary school level. And this is creating a problem because the numbers now are so inflated to the extent that whoever gets 98% does not even get admitted to whatever college he wants. So we are defeating the purpose. So currently we are considering to have a skills oriented to measure the performance of the student rather than the insufficient ways to identify talented students. There are no mechanisms for that. Poor services in university hospitals. University hospitals take about quarter of our total budget of the higher education. And they were considering it to move to the health ministry. But of course, this is refused utterly because it's a training hospital and it has to be there. So we are really having a problem in those higher education hospitals. There are no small numbers of students sent on missions abroad, and that is also creating a problem. Despite the fact that we are having a lot of funds dedicated to that, but yet we don't have sufficient qualified either through language. So we really have to reform our program to prepare the students more appropriate for 100 to 300 or 400. So that is another problem. But the foremost problem is what Professor Maria has raised, is the transition from secondary to tertiary education, the poor entry level of the higher education from secondary school graduates. It is really we are suffering because everybody, you know, is trained to rather memorize rather than think. And that is a real problem that we are having. And the central admission does not enable placement according to student desire. Only one criteria, as I mentioned earlier. So depending on private tutoring, most of the students are depending on giving support from extra support. And the mode of delivery encourages memorizing, not creating. Also, there is a very big problem that we are facing, the conflicts between the Ministry of Higher Education, the Supreme Council of Universities, Supreme Council of Private Universities, and Ministry of Technical and Education Training. Those ministries, first of all, and there is a big, I would say, chaos in the governance of the education system in general, because we used to have one minister for the whole education to have an overall vision for the education. Then they were separated. Then they created another ministry for technical and vocational education. Then now, last Saturday, they merged the Ministry of Higher Education with the Ministry of Scientific Research and Ministry of Education with the Ministry of Technical Education. So this unstable condition in the governance of our system is creating a problem. Now, when we try to envision for the quality or the improvement of the reform, we have to think about sustainability of the reform activities, the access and equity to free education. There are constitutional rights that we have to abide with, the quality and relevance of the system, the ownership. It's very important whether to go top down or bottom up. We try to target the bottom up approach, but it is inevitable to go from top to down. Public-private partnerships with industry and the community is, we have a gap here that we have to address. The labor market relevance and needs, the competitive reform initiatives and mechanisms, this is a mechanism that is highly accepted for being transparent and giving chance to equal opportunity to institutions to benefit. And foremost, having incentive schemes at all levels, because at the end of the game, everybody would pose a question, what is in it for me? And whether we like it or not, you know, this is how it works. Just to give you a flavor of the size of our higher education institutions, they are formed of public universities. We have 23 public universities, 371 colleges, and we have 102 colleges affiliation guided or affiliation, open education. We have technical colleges. We will have a stream for Al-Azhar University, which is 77 faculties, and this is not under the Ministry of Higher Education. It's under the Islamic University, the ministry. The private universities, we have 25 universities that incorporate 226 colleges. The higher private institutes, we have about 150 institutes, and middle private institutes. This here captures the framework for education and training in Egypt. And this is a very important drawing, really, that sums up the whole education structure, starting from kindergarten and going to primary, secondary, and then general secondary certificate. And then what we used to have for the technical education is just, it stops at 2 years and that's it. And the community perception was very low on this kind, and it was not able to attract. And we believe that in Egypt, this is one of the most important streams to look into. And for that reason, we have extended, we made parallel tracks for the higher education universities, and then the technical colleges giving 2, 3, and 4 year programs, as well as diplomas, technological degrees in masters and PhD. And we have a very similar remuneration structure to attract people to continue in the technical branch. We have also mapped our education system with the competencies that are developed. We have four competency levels, as well as the national qualifications framework. We have developed also the national qualifications framework that constitutes eight different levels. And and each level shows the exit to the labor market. So the bottom here is representing the labor market, and those dotted lines represent the exits to the labor market from every individual level. And this is very important to tie the whole education system. Also, we have this level here is entrepreneurship education, which was discussed yesterday. And we think that entrepreneurship education is not necessarily, because the way it is perceived, it is just for job creation. But we think that entrepreneurship education promotes innovative and creative thinking. And for that reason, we cannot just consider it for the higher education. It has to be starting from the kindergartens onwards. And we have developed an ecosystem and a business model and everything in that respect. But what we really lack is the proper coordination among all the main players. And the entrepreneurship goes for entrepreneurship extracurricular activities. the cross-curricular, which is it is inherent within the program, the education program, as well as the eShip dedicated curriculums and centers for entrepreneurships and so on the university levels. So this really here captures the whole education structure map together. And the problem we have is the interface between the secondary schooling and the university because of the very reasons that were Professor Maria mentioned in her intervention. We also developed an integrated quality model in higher education where you have the institutions determine their mission statements, the goals and aims, the expected outcomes, and there is an input and a process and the output to in order to realize those missions and achieve the goals and so on. And this model here is adopted by a national quality assurance agency that we have established to look into the quality system. The national quality assurance started in 2007, but really the only two institutions were accredited in 2010. In 2014, they reached about 61, and the distribution, the table down there shows per university how many institutions are accredited. Now in 2015, I think they reached about 75, but still we are very much delayed, and we are starting for those two universities here the reaccreditation process as well. The governance structure of the Egyptian higher education, you can see from here, those are the government ministries that are directly engaged with the Ministry of Education, the Ministry of Finance, Ministry of Planning, and Ministry of Higher Education. And here on the right side, the community levels, and in the middle, you have the universities and higher education institutions, our national qualifications authority, and the student here. What I just want to show is here is that we are trying to target that the financing of students, because our system is free education in the public sector, it is free education. But if you are requesting from the institutions to deliver quality programs, then quality has a cost and somebody has to pay that cost. So it is free education, it has to be between the Ministry of Finance to fund the students. And for that reason, we are inviting this model, the Higher Education Funding Council for Education, so that the budgets for universities are really determined based on the students rather than just direct negotiations or a percentage. The roles and responsibilities are spelled here in government bodies from ministries, supreme councils, and the roles vary from planning, policy making, implementation, and so forth. Those are very regular things. The way the funding is done mainly is from the government. We don't have any funding formula available, and the problem is that every president of university negotiates his budget with the Ministry of Planning and the Ministry of Finance, and at the end of the game, depending on the available funds, they just increase by 5 or 9%, which really defeats the purpose of any problem, because if you are wanting to comply with the national academic reference standards and the quality, the conditions for accreditation, you really have to maintain certain norms. And to do that, you need 2.5 to 3 times the budgets that are doing. So every university has to set its own priority to make sure. We have different, diverse, the good thing is that we have diverse sources of funding from the World Bank, for European Union, USAID, UNESCO, the Ford Foundation, DFID, and so many funding also from bilateral agreements, because many countries like Italy, Germany, Austria, and so forth, they are very much interested to support the Egyptians, depending on their expertise in technical and vocational education and so forth. The current project that I am directing here as the chief of party is called the Higher Education Partnerships Program. And that is after we really identified the weaknesses between the partners, the partnership among our universities and the private sector and the industry and so forth. So we are getting a grant, a $250 million grant from the USAID, basically to dedicated for sending missions abroad as well as promoting the partnerships through competitive funding. And the basic overall objective is to facilitate the partnership between Egyptian and U.S. higher education and Egyptian U.S. businesses to enhance the higher education and align the research with industry needs, contributing to Egypt's human capital and economic growth. This is basically, and it has three basic objectives, and they all match with the overall developmental objectives that we are talking about, improving the quality and relevance. Quality really is a buzzword, and this is what we are really focusing on, and this is what causes the imbalance between the private higher education and the public, because we are trying to scrutiny the public education to make sure that they are delivering quality work, because the law that was developed is they are for profit, and we are trying to encourage the development of not-for-profit education. And that is also a problem, because we really need to attract some. We only have one university, that is the American University in Cairo, which is a not-for-profit organization, but that is only attracting 5,000 or 6,000. And the whole private education is attracting universities, less than 3 to 5%. So we are far from having extra support to the government to create the funding. However, when we consider the higher education institutions, it reaches about 20% or so. Here, our thoughts of the development is the virtuous circle for the higher education development, and it is based on four pillars: the academic, the institutional, the commercial, social, and the policy level. And the, the academic innovation builds competence of faculty and students. The institutional upgrades and building capabilities and linkages. The social skills, graduates, and useful research fuel. And the policies are made to support. So the better policies you have, the better academic performance you will have, and so on. And this goes on to increase the impact on the higher education. Here we are trying to establish this partnership program. On the left side here, this is the traditional partnership, university per university, and having a technical assistance at the center here. But that is has very little limited impact and limited outcome. And that's why we are trying to establish what we call learning innovation networks, LINs, to promote the collaboration and the dissemination of the information or the partnerships among two universities. However, the rest of the universities can benefit from all those. So we target 20, establishing 21 substantially improved university programs aligned with the sector needs, 6 dual degree programs with U.S. universities established, 2,000 Egyptian professors with improved pedagogical skills. Those are indicators we put to test whether we have accomplished what we are doing or not. And the widespread awareness of the higher education partnership achievement, and the publication, the number of publications to be done, and of course, address the most and foremost thing is to address the policy issues that are required to support such partnerships. In conclusion, I mean, one has to really look at the global deficiencies that we all are witnessing in all the diverse branches and make sure that we are taking coordinated steps towards improving those agendas. Thank you very much.
Hello? Yeah. Thank you very much, Professor Said. I think that one of the points called my attention is that the importance of international cooperation and technical assistance coming from other countries, I think for the big BRICS countries, this is probably less important because of the relative size of the countries. But still, I remember that in Brazil, the way the higher education system was organized in the 60s was based on a U.S. AD mission, which came here and told us that all institutions should be like Harvard, and we're still paying for that. So I'll open for questions and discussions.
And I'd like to appreciate your speaking because I have two comments or two questions about cooperation and networks and funding, international funding. Oh, I spoke to White because I didn't, maybe I forget. So I'd like to talk and to listen about the possibility to solve our problems. And I think that this moment is for it because we are discussing about the policies. So I imagine that we are creating something different for us. So my first question or my first comment is how and when are we create a kind of cooperation networks in higher education with BRICS example of Bologna Treaty, and something as international accreditation or students' mobility, because we don't have it, and now in the south of Brazil and in Brazil in general, or not in Latin America, or in BRICS, for example. And about the funding, we have lost the possibility to participate at international funding. Like European Commission, like Horizon 2020. We have lost this possibility last year, I remember maybe. And because we are considered at a strong economy because we are BRICS, we are from BRICS. So I'd like to talk or to listen about these two issues.
Another question?
I have a question concerning for-profit higher education sector, and what's the problem and issues in your for-profit higher education, and how do you encourage non-profit higher education to grow? Thank you.
How do you what?
Encourage no. Your non-profit higher education to grow.
Ruby. Okay.
Thank you. I'd like to pose once more my previous question now regarding the experience of Egypt. If you'd have any case to tell us about when the tertiary sector education meets the secondary or the primary educational system to transfer to them their knowledge and somehow to pay back the fact that you have mentioned that the government is the main provider of public education.
What?
I mean, you have mentioned that the government is a very great stakeholder, meaning the financing of tertiary education. So I would wonder if you have any case in Egypt to tell us about in which the people who are enrolled in the tertiary sector somehow meet the secondary system and the primary system to transfer to them a bit of their knowledge and to pay back what they get from the government and from the taxpayers regarding free education, a non-governmental solution to our problem.
One question more, and Pandit, please.
Yeah, my question is about why is Egypt so dependent on foreign aid? This is not unique to Egypt, but it is.
I'm sorry, we are not hearing.
Yes. Did you hear? You didn't hear the question?
No, why don't you repeat it, please?
My question is, why is Egypt so dependent on foreign aid in the higher education sector? This is a concern not only in Egypt, but across Africa. Colonialists left a half a century ago, but a new form of dependency has crept in. And this has huge costs in terms of the country's autonomy in terms of policy making. So I'd like you to respond to that question.
I think there is one more question. No? Yes, Babaczewski.
My question is about the, I think it addressed some of the questions made by Professor Feng Xiao, which is how you can encourage the non-for-profit private sector. Because in Brazil, we had a very disastrous situation because we enforced a highly tight evaluation over the private sector. And what happens is that the non-for-profit sector institutions went down, and we are now under a strong process of concentration into for-profit institutions in Brazil. So all the community, more basic colleges and small faculties and things like that just were whip it out from the Brazilian scene. I think maybe it's not only for poor quality, but because the cost of the evaluation was too high for them. And then what happened in Brazil is that nowadays the big for-profit teaching only institutions are dominating the scene in Brazil.
Okay, I think one
I think I'll,
yeah.
We'll have to
just that's the last question here, and then okay.
Thank you. Mine is actually very kind of it's just a comment I would like to hear from you about the impact of the Arab Spring on higher education. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Your turn again.
Well, I was hoping to raise some provoking questions, but they are too provoking, actually. So, but let me try to respond. I mean, about cooperation and student mobility, we are promoting this through also participating with the European Union, and we have a missions department that caters for student mobility to increase their going to study abroad and those kind of you know, like the Erasmus Mundus and the mobility grants and all those mechanisms are well in place in Egypt to cater for that. You were talking about the funding or something?
Yeah.
What? Yeah, we are having exactly the same mechanisms with other European and funding bodies to fund those activities.
But our problem is the funding in general, because in this in your speech and from China and India, we have the same problem.
Yeah.
So I don't know if it's possible to discuss about some policies. Regarding funding, international funding.
The way we are funded with international organizations is through our Ministry of International Planning. They have about 58 partner groups that are communicating and trying to see how best we can develop our education, not only the education system, but other forms of collaboration, of course. But the education system has a kind of priority in there. And we try through the Ministry of International Cooperation to identify who are the partners that would really finance the mobilities and so forth. There are also, we have developed a fund called Education Development Fund, as well as the two funds, actually, and another one for Science and Technology Development Fund. Now, you can apply for those funds to either go to do some part-time research activities outside, or to try to prepare for a partnership, so getting some seed funds to benefit from. And those ministries, they have mechanisms through which you can apply. Also, our missions department do address this the issue. But the problem lies within the limited amount of funding that is available from the government. And sometimes, because of the problems, the unstable situation within the government, the current government now, and the changes have been frequently happening over the 4-5 years, setting their own priorities, usually they go from, take the funds from such mobility grants and so forth. And the end result is really not having sufficient funding to support. But just to answer your question, yes, we have a funding mechanism, but it is of limited to the funding that is obtained from foreign support. Encouraging not-for-profit, the not-for-profit is one of the major things that we have. We are doing this through government to government. It's like, for instance, the Japanese, they have created a very top-notch university, research-oriented university, that is not-for-profit, and it is co-funded by the Japanese and the Egyptian. The Japanese will have some professors coming and sending people to study two years in Japan and 2 years in Egypt, and it's a very nice model. We have, like, our major newspapers that are making a lot of profit, they have established not-for-profit universities, or we are requesting. Major corporations that are offering as a social contribution from their side, they are invited to also invest for establishing not-for-profit organizations. But this, quite honestly, is moving a very, very slow. We only have two, and we have three in the pipeline that are negotiating and trying to establish not-for-profit organizations. Tertiary, the foreign dependence on funding. Well, I think I said before in the beginning that the government is not able to cater for the higher education or give full support, and that's why it is inviting the private sector as well as other bilateral agreements, because this is the political arena. You know, it's based on either multilateral agreements or bilateral agreements, and those bilateral agreements are basically to fulfill our own agendas. There is nothing that is dictated through that. And I'm aware that you are talking about colonialism and a different form of colonialism through the education side, but I don't think this is the case, because those bilateral agreements are used, or we try to use them to fulfill our basic requirements and needs. So I don't know if that answers the question or not.
Uh,
And about this, tertiary and secondary, I think one of the things that you're talking about the graduates from the tertiary that give support to the secondary, or well, one of the major problems we have, as Professor Maria mentioned, is the teacher, the teacher and the quality of the teachers and so forth. And we try to attract the graduates in order to support the secondary and primary education and get enrolled, because the level of the teachers that we have are not up to the level to cater for making a smooth transfer between the secondary and the high school level. So the graduates from there, many of them are enrolled into the teacher education, because we have over 1.1 or 1.5, 2 million teachers, but many of them are not up to the level of that. So we are trying to change this here. And what else? The last question was
The Arab Spring.
The Arab Spring. Of course, let me say some differentiation between the branches or the higher education that we have is a little bit different than what is going on in Qatar and Emirates and so forth, because they have full branch campuses and that are offering 4-degree programs in their, but in our case, it's different. I mean, the private education are established, although they take the name German University, French University, and so on, but they are fully Egyptian universities that are established either through respective governments, like China is establishing a new university in Egypt, and Russia is establishing a new university in Egypt. So many of those countries, however, those are not branch campuses, but they are fully under the Egyptian law and so on. The Arab Spring, I don't think it is affecting, I mean, I'm talking about the higher education, because we have for long lost a lot of the students that were coming from the Arab region admitted into our education system. So it did not really make much difference in the our admission of students from outside, and even sending professors to the Arab countries. Many of the Arab countries used to depend on Egyptian faculty members because of the language, and they had a lot of trust and so forth. But this is one of the areas where it has been affected quite considerably, because they already, though the Arab countries have already established their faculty members and getting from abroad and so forth. So.
Okay, thank you very much. I would like just to make one comment. I think there is an issue of international cooperation, which, for instance, when we started with this project, we discussed the question of which kind of cooperation between the BRICS countries. And as you know, there is a BRICS organization. And supposedly, you have some kind of cooperation. I think there is something happening. But basically, whenever you look at higher education, you see that even in Europe, where you have the Bologna model, and you have all the involvement in creating mobility among countries within the European Union, most of the issues on higher education, they are national issues. And in our project, it's very clear that these are very different countries. They are very, the internal problems are very, very, very significant. The culture is very significant. They are very different. And there isn't really much you can do in terms of international cooperation. Of course, whatever you can do, it's good. But you cannot expect that this will evolve very much. There is an effort in South America to create some mobility between the South American countries in the Mercosur system, and it has not moved very much. I think it's for the same reason, because the countries are very different, the realities are very different, and you cannot really expect very much on that. So I think
South-South mobility is
It's an issue. I think it's time to stop here. We can continue to talk at coffee, and then we'll resume here at 11. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.